Thank you for the introduction and for inviting me to give this presentation. So this is the title, Pattern Level Monte Carlo for EIC. And it will be, my presentation will be mostly about pattern level Monte Carlo, not very much specified for EIC, but I will get there also. So the outline will be, I will say a little bit about Monte Carlo integration in general, then about amplitude calculation, phase-based generation. Then I will talk about improved transverse momentum factorization. This is something that, if I am correctly, Francesco Siliberto already mentioned in his talk. And I will finally go to some phenomenology, which includes EIC phenomenology. So, but as I said, I will start more about the Monte Carlo method, and in particular for pattern level cross sections. So the general problem is that you will have to calculate integrals, pattern level cross sections, and these integrals have a general factorized form. Can you see my mouse?
Not really. Can you move it a little bit?
I'm moving it now.
Yeah, so we can't see it.
You can't see it. Okay.
No.
I don't know how to switch that on. But it should be okay. So this first blue line shows the factorized formula for pattern level cross section. There are something which can be identified as I written then as a general momentum distributions for initial state momenta, pattern level initial state momenta, and the platonic cross section for final state momenta. And then this is a general formula. Let's say if you have a collinearly factorized formula, these general momentum distributions would, of course, only depend on momentum fraction of the initial state hadron. Consider hadron collisions. But then there is also KT factorization. We heard already about that. I will be talking about that too. And then it's a bit more complicated. And this initial state distribution depends on two variables. Of course, it depends often also on an extra scale, but I'm talking about, let's say, the kinematical variables that go into the momenta. Then there is the differential cross section, partonic differential cross section. And here there is this matrix element that depends on initial state pattern level momenta and final state momenta. It's a complicated object, especially if you have several final state momenta. Let's say you have bunch of jets. So there will be a bunch of gluons and quarks in the final state. It can become very complicated. And it involves also the differential phase space, which is some higher dimensional manifold as function of momentum components. And then in this formula, I also write a theta, which represents the necessary phase space cuts if you have a certain level of perturbation theory, but I will be mostly talking about tree level. Then you need to make sure that the final state particles don't hit any singularities that are present inside the matrix element while you integrate them. They cannot become too collinear and they cannot become too soft. And this is something that I separate from the matrix element. I say that is part of phase space cuts. So this is how it looks for hadron collisions. For electron hadron collisions, it become actually a bit simpler. Namely, one of the initial states doesn't have a distribution anymore. It's just a electron momentum. So from that point of view, it's actually makes life a bit simpler, even. Now, I wrote a program that does all this for you. So it calculates matrix elements, it integrates them, creates event files, you can even make histograms and so on for it. And it is in that sense not, and everything on pattern level. And it is in that sense, from that functionality, not unique to other programs, but this one is unique because it can deal with KT factorization. So when it comes to programs that pattern level programs that are completely automatized and can deal with several final states, that's the only one that can deal with the initial states, bottom level initial states that have kt. And I want to talk a bit about what goes inside there and how it works. And in particular, the calculation of the matrix elements is interesting because the way it's done, it's similarly done in the first two that I mentioned here in this first point, Algin and Hallock. It comes, the way how to calculate this is essentially dictated by field theory itself. So let's say the algorithm that allows you to do this for arbitrary processes is coming from field theory itself. And so that is the first part that I want to present because I think it's interesting and, well, cute. But, first I need to explain something regarding Monte Carlo integration. So that's the method that we apply to calculate these cross-sections because the integration phase is so complicated, the integrands are so complicated, there's not really another way to feasibly do that. And in general, Monte Carlo integration is about integrating multidimensional integrals, calculating multidimensional integrals. So let's say you have a manifold M, complicated manifold can be complicated. For example, a particle phase space where you have on-shell conditions and momentum conservation. And it has some dimension omega, which can become, 2, 3, 10, 15 even dimensional. So the Monte Carlo method then is based on essentially the central limit theorem. So the idea is that I know how to evaluate this function f for a given integration point. That I know how to do. And I have another function, a probability density living on this manifold, and I have it completely under control. I can evaluate it and I can generate points in this manifold that are distributed following this probability density G. Then I can construct a random variable is this Xn, which is the average of the ratio of these two functions. The average over a number of points that are generated following this density G. And this random variable for large n converges to the integral I want. So the expectation value of this random variable is exactly the integral that I want to integrate, calculate, yes. And besides expectation value of a random variable, I also know a formula for the variance and this variance decreases with the number of integration points that I use. So in mathematics books, when they talk about central limit theorem, they define this what I write as square root of as xn here, they define it with 1/√n. So that this variance is a constant. But for Monte Carlo integration, this variance represents the uncertainty in your calculation. And the idea is that this indeed goes down if you throw more and more points. I have here a formula how you can calculate the integral, right, as this average over the ratios of function and density. I don't have here yet a formula for this variance, but there's also an estimator for that. So you can indeed also estimate an error that you have at a certain number of integration points that you used. And the nice thing about the Monte Carlo method is that this all is completely independent of the integration space. This holds for any dimension. And there are many methods that are much better than the Monte Carlo method, but they work, for example, only in a few dimensions. But if you go to higher dimensions, they don't work so nicely anymore. Now, I formulated this slide such that I immediately can introduce important sampling because I didn't say what this G exactly should be. At the beginning, I only wrote, okay, it should be not zero if this function is not zero, and that's it. For the rest, you should just have it under control, and then it works already, but maybe not optimally. What you want to do, you see, you take this ratio of F and G all the time, so you want this G to look as much as F as possible, so the fluctuation is as small as possible. In the ideal case, G would be exactly the normalized version of F, but that would simply mean that you solved your integration. If you are able to generate points that are exactly distributed following F, this means that you solved your integration problem somehow and you wouldn't bother with this whole story anymore. So in practice, this never happens. And this F is too complicated to exactly match. So you find a G that behaves more or less as F as much as possible so that this fluctuation is as small as possible and you calculate the average and the convergence is as quick as possible. So this is what I presented here is called Monte Carlo integration. There's also something which is called Monte Carlo simulation. So in integration, you say, okay, I can evaluate this F, this function that I want to integrate. It might be complicated, but at least this I can do point by point. But there might be situations where this F is so complicated that you're not even able to do that anymore. Like, for example, if you would like to calculate the matrix element of hadron-hadron goes to 100 hadrons, right? That's impossible. So then you need to do something which is Monte Carlo simulation. And you say, okay, I cannot evaluate this F, but I can make sure that this G itself already looks as F as much as possible in the important pieces of the space where I integrate. So then you just generate points X and you don't calculate this average anymore, but you just hope that this G is close enough to this F so that you can just calculate the average. And then you are able to, for example, to calculate, that is what happens in a Patron shower Monte Carlo, for example. But I will be talking only about this integration. And okay, I can say, for example, instead of integrating exactly this function, I can say I want to calculate the integral of this function, but in a restricted area for a certain variable, for a certain coordinate. I say I want to actually calculate a bin. And the idea is that you can use exactly the same function, exactly the same setup as I just described to do that. And eventually what you do is you say, okay, I generate points following G, I calculate this ratio, and then I throw this weight into a bin, right? And I can do this with a whole range of bins at the same time. And I will call this, I generate an event, and I throw this event in a bin. But what I'm really doing is calculating integrals. You calculate these integrals that correspond to these bins. It's not simulation, it's truly integration, okay? So I want us to be clear. Right, so now I will go to how to calculate amplitudes with, and I will mainly stick to tree level, but with many particles involved and to do it in an efficient way. And in order to explain that, I will go back to a very basic description of quantum field theory, namely zero-dimensional field theory. Okay, so I have a path integral, which consists of, so my space consists of one point, and in this one point lives one field, phi, and the path integral is just this integral. Integral over phi, exponent of, is a current, j, right, multiplied by phi, and then there is an action, and this action, as you can recognize, maybe is something like phi cube theory. And this integral, if I make sure that the real part of the exponent is always negative, and this converges, this integral, and I can make sure that this happens if I say that this m squared has a small imaginary part. And that is essentially Feynman prescription. There's a small minus I epsilon there, makes this exponent always, the real part always negative, so this integral converges. It's nicely well defined. And now can I very easily see that this object here, this is a generating function, right? Path integral generating function. It satisfies a differential equation. This is simply because this integrand vanishes at plus infinity and minus infinity. So if I integrate the derivative of the integrand, right, then I have simply the integrand at the endpoints is zero. but I can explicitly take this derivative and then translate it into the derivatives with J, and I get a differential equation. So this generating function that I have, this is essentially the explicitly the solution to this differential equation. And I can make my life now even more difficult than I already made it with this differential equation. Say, okay, I write this z as e to the power w and see what equation I get for w. And then you get a nonlinear equation. And now I can say, okay, now let's try to solve this equation using a power expansion. So expand w into powers of j. Right? It's just expansion, and I put it in. And I get relations between the coefficients for these powers of j, call them c. And I start counting at n is one. So I start at n is zero, but I start with c with the linear term. So and when you put this in this previous equation, so you put this in this sum, you put it in this last nonlinear equation, you get a nonlinear relation between these coefficients. And now I say, okay, I'm going to very suggestively interpret this relation that I got directly from the path integral essentially. See, I say, okay, I have here a cn plus one on the left-hand side, and I write this as a blob with n inside and a leg sticking out. And then I have here, this is the n is one term. This is the linear term. Right, this is this in the zero is equal to j plus stuff. This is this j, right? This one separate linear term, that is this delta n is one. I say that is just a line. And then there is this double sum. I say, okay, this double sum is a product of such blobs with an I and a j and a leg sticking out, right? This I plus one, j plus one. And there is a factor g in front of the sum. And this factor g I represent as a vertex. And then there's the third term. This one has an n plus two. So I say, okay, there are two legs sticking out of this leg, of this blob, n plus two, two legs. And they come together again in a vertex, g. But I also have something that looks like an explicit loop now. And that I say is a factor h bar. And there is a factor a half. So it starts to very suggestively writing it like this. It starts to look like a graphical equation. Now there are all these factorials, and I interpret them such that there is some kind of equivalence between this n represents some kind of symmetry, and that's why it inherently does a 1 over n factorial inside to represent the symmetry. Now I'm going to get rid of that. I'm going to say, let's make this path integral a bit more realistically and say I don't have one space point or one spacetime point, but lots of them. And my action becomes a little bit more complicated. I have now some correlations, two-point correlations in the action. And I can go through this exercise again. And the main difference will be that now this generating function will have powers of the currents, but they live in different spacetime points. So there's not only one J, but there are a number of them, and they correspond to all the possible phase space spacetime points. This equation then becomes slightly more complicated in the sense that a line will now correspond to an inverse of this matrix, and a vertex carries indices. And what I'm going to do now is say, okay, I'm only interested in these coefficients for which these i1 until ik are all 0 or 1. So I only look at the single powers of these j, but there can be still an arbitrary number of them. And I can apply this recursive relation on only those coefficients. The thing is that then all these factors, they disappear because it's just it's at most one, and the model coming here should be I plus one. Okay, and I can then work out what this recursive relation represents really, and I'll do that. I'll now imagine that, okay, I'm going to make an expansion in these loops, right? This is what I said, it is represent h bar is a small number, so I can make an expansion and treat this equation order by order in h bar. And I can start with h bar 0 and say, I don't take this last term into account. And then this recursive relation simplifies, of course, one term is missing. And now I can say, I have, let's say, the coefficients C, where I start with a one where there are four of these I's that are equal to one, but different ones. And I call them number one, number two, number three, and number four. And then this relation looks as follows. This object with one, two, three, four, according to this rule, decomposes into these
seven objects.
Right, so it says I have to include all possible splittings. So I can split in two groups of 2 times 2 or 3 plus 1, four possibilities. And then for each of the blobs that you see with only three legs sticking out, you can do the same. And what you get is that this original left-hand side becomes a sum of something that looks exactly like Feynman graphs. And in fact, these are all the Feynman graphs that you would need for a 5-point amplitude in a scalar theory with only 3-point vertices. So this recursive relation gives you the graphs. So you start from the generating function, and you see inside this generating function hidden is the graph already. And you can see that structure comes out like this. Okay, this is tree level. Let's look at one loop. Now I say I restrict myself to these coefficients that have exactly one loop. So the relation is the thing with one loop decomposes into the part where one blob has a loop and the other one doesn't, or the loop comes from this explicit loop, this extra term. So what are the possibilities? On the left-hand side, I have a simple example, one loop, two external legs. According to the rules in yellow up there, there are three possibilities. Two with one implicit loop, and one is the 1, 2 and the 2, 1. And the third one is this last term where the loop is explicit. Now, the first two obviously are these type of self-energy graphs. And the third one, I can imagine that I cut this vertex open and then I have a tree-level object and I know the tree-level recursion already. So I put this inside and I find these on the right-hand side, these five graphs. So the first three are the self-energy graphs and they carry a factor half as they should. The last two graphs are identical, but they carry both a half. So in total, this is exactly the one vertex correction that you also need. So you get exactly the loop graph that you need from this recursive relation. And I've even example at two loops. Also at two loops, it works perfectly out. You get exactly the right symmetry factors. Okay. So you see how the graphical structure of quantum field theory is hidden from the start in, let's say, in the Lagrangian already.
Excuse me, may I ask the question at this point? This method, this is exactly what you apply in this Monte Carlo. So this is an operative method, or is just for
you? I will explain that. So okay. I'm not finished yet. So what I now only explained is that you see that there is the graphs coming out from the quantum field theory. Quantum field theory tells you already from the start there will be graphs. Right. Now, this all these examples were very simple scalar theory on true LTCs. You can imagine then if you have a more complicated Lagrangian, these relations become more complicated, but the principle is the same. So you could have something with 4-point vertices, like if you have a purely gluonic QCD, right? You have 3-point and 4-point vertices, but you can also have other types of particles. You can have the difference between fermions, antifermions, and vector bosons, and you'll get, for example, instead of only one relation, you have three relations that work in parallel, but the principle is still the same. And of course, you understand that the interpretation of these legs is exactly the explicit legs that I number one and two here, for example, right? These are the external particles, the external on-shell particles, and the internal lines are the virtual lines. And you can also formulate this in momentum space, and you will have momentum conservation in the vertices. This comes all on top of that. What I told you doesn't tell you is the LSZ formula, right? Because we know for quantum field theory you also need, but this is really a recursion relation for, as I presented it, for green functions. Of course, on top of this, you have to amputate them. But the graphs are already, let's say, inside the graphs are already inside the green in the green function. The green function recursion also already gives you the recursion that gives you the graphs. On top of that, you have to formally do the truncation. So now to answer Michał's question. What I've been showing you now is forward recursion. I start with a complicated object and I show that it decomposes into simpler objects that eventually are graphs. Now, the way to calculate these graphs is to do exactly the opposite. So let's look at tree level. There's the same relation in yellow. Now I go top down. Top down. I went bottom up. Now I go top down. So I have a number of external lines. Let's say I have a number of external polarization vectors over them. And I simply take all combination of two of them, and these will define blobs that I have in this first square. Once I have those, I follow the rule of the recursion and I construct all blobs with one more leg, the darker green ones. And this relation in yellow above says exactly how to do that. And then finally, I construct the biggest blob. So, I know that if I start with the biggest, the darkest green blob in the bottom, and I go through the recursion up, I get all the graphs. So I simply go to the recursion backwards. So this blob that I get here is exactly this green function or the amplitude, if you wish. And what is so nice about this is, you see, in the beginning, there is this, the very first term is this light green blob 1, 2. So I calculate that. And I, let's say in a computer program, you calculate it and you store it. And then you come to the calculation of the darker green blobs. And you see this, the lighter green blob with the 1 and 2 appears like 3 times. You can see it in the, okay, you can't see my mouse, but if you track all the light green blobs, you see it appears 3 times. And you calculate it only once. So what this algorithm does for you is exactly what you see that should happen if you calculate Feynman graphs. If you have many Feynman graphs and you look at two graphs, you see there are pieces of subgraphs that are identical and that you could factorize. And this algorithm does this automatically from you from the start. So this is the way, at least at tree level, completely straightforward, how to calculate amplitudes. Now, these, what I represent here as vertices and lines that are, of course, eventually, the vertices from field theory and the propagators from field theory. So there are some number of operations involved in each vertex. But eventually, this is, if you have very many external particles, the most efficient way to calculate amplitudes, at least for a numerical application, like in the Monte Carlo application, where you want to have eventually the at the amplitude of a matrix element as a simply as a number. So here is a number of blobs, and there is a number of terms. And I write it now more as it would be seen in a computer program. You don't have to have to look at it in details at it, but the same, the number of terms that you see here in this page is the same as the number of lines here, 25. And there are objects that are numbered from 1 until 15, and that are exactly the blobs. And this blue, this thing in blue is simply identical, is equivalent to these drawings. I just didn't want to draw the drawings anymore. So it's the same thing, just explicitly with encoding of the momenta that are involved, et cetera, et cetera. But this gives me an opportunity without drawing all the graphs to look at something more realistic. Like if you need the amplitude for e plus e minus and a photon, then it looks like that. And if you look at the at some pink lines of an example, so one line is not just a multiplication anymore, but it's just like the contraction of spin loss with vector bosons and propagators. So these are simply the operations that the field theory tells you, right? There are vertices, and each line corresponds to the operations that have to be performed to evaluate a vertex. Okay. So when it comes to Monte Carlo calculation, the idea is that, so amplitude, the calculation of the amplitudes is encoded by such a list. So this list you create before you run your Monte Carlo, and this list tells you all the operations that you have to do phase base point by phase base point in order to get a value of the amplitude. So the idea is that creating this list can take some time. You just throw all possible combinations at it until you have the list right. But once you have it, you can just, this list tells you which operations to perform in order to get the amplitude phase base point, phase base point by phase base point. Now, in order to calculate a matrix element, you don't need only the amplitude. I explained to you how to calculate an amplitude in an efficient way, but you also need to square it, just an amplitude, and sum of the spins and colors. And since we are using a Monte Carlo method for the phase space integration, the object that you have to integrate and sum is positive, absolute value squared, you could consider doing this summation also in a Monte Carlo way. And for spin, this is very straightforward. You could just throw random helicities for your external particles. If each event gets explicit helicities, you can also use something more advanced like random polarization. So instead of discrete helicities, you throw continuous polarization, so it becomes like an extra integration. This is more efficient, but you know, the interpretation of the event by event basis is not so obvious. And if you want to, so in KT, I use helicities because it's easier to give an interpretation to the helicity to an event so that each particle has explicit helicity. But the question is, can we deal with color sum in a similar way? And the thing is that, as I said, each vertex in these drawings that I had and in this list corresponds to a vertex from field theory. And in QCD, this involves also these vertices. They have also color. There's operations involved that have to do with color. And if you think of a vertex as a thing that depends on the number of indices, right? I have here the A1, A2, A3, and let's say also the Lorentz indices. And each of them, let's say the Lorentz indices have 4 values and the adjoint color indices have 8 values, then this represents an enormous tensor. You're not gonna do this numerically for each event, for each vertex, for each graph all the time. You know that for Lorentz indices is not so bad because it's not like this object is really a 4x4 tensor with where you have to contract and do all these multiplications because it's in a sense sparse. There are lots of zeros. We know that, you know, the metric tensor is not a 4x4 tensor. It has only four non-zero numbers. So for the Lorentz indices, it's clear that it's better. But how to deal with this column? Well, the fact is that this FABC or F1, F2, FA1, FA2, FA3, as I write it, is also almost always zero. There are only very specific combinations of values for these A1, A2, and A3 for which this F is not zero. And it's even so good that it's almost that the external, if you let's say have a number of gluons, external gluons, and you give them color, 1, 3, 8, 7, 6, 3, 5, whatever, all of them explicit color, that the internal lines almost have a well-defined value, single value also. It's almost like you have a conservation law, like this color plus this color means third color is a single value. Because this FABCs, they are almost always zero. If A is 1 and B is 2, then C must be 3, else this thing is zero. It's true for almost all other combinations except 2. If it's 4 and 5, it can be 3 or 8, not just 3 or just 8. And if it's 6 or 7, then the third one can be 3 or 8. So it, as a consequence of this, if you think about this, the external colors of, if you would do a color Monte Carlo and you give random colors to external gluons, then in this blue table that I showed you, this table depends on the event because these color combinations are not unique. But in principle, it's doable to live with that, but eventually you prefer another method to deal with color. And explicitly sum over color, but to use another color representation. This is this color flow representation, where you say quarks I treat like they are, as I know in QCD, they have fundamental indices, but I give the gluons, I give them also fundamental indices. And you can do that in a system, in a straightforward way. You can formulate your three gluon vertex in terms of fundamental indices instead of adjoint indices. The four gluon also, it looks much more complicated. There are more terms for sure, but it's only Kronecker delta, so that makes it simple. And we know that Kronecker deltas are almost always zero. They are only non-zero when the indices are identical. So although there's, you know, a lot of indices, this thing is almost always zero because for each delta, Kronecker delta, the indices must be identical. Right, and so what is important is that the way I present it here, where I say an amplitude where you have an external gluon and which carries a joint index, I turn this into a pair of fundamental indices by simply contracting this with a color generator. And the thing is that the sum for the squared object over adjoint colors is the same then as the sum over fundamental colors of the squared object. So this doesn't change. The only tricky part is this quark gluon vertex, which gets this so-called, gets this explicit 1 over NC correction. This is the QCD photon, as it's sometimes called. And why is this useful? So again, you could do this tactic that I said before, do the column Monte Carlo, but now instead of generating for the gluons, single adjoint color, you generate a pair of fundamental colors. And then again, you have the same issue. You know, the internal lines almost always have well-defined single color indices, single values for the color indices, but not always. So again, you the what I call this the skeleton, the algorithm to calculate the amplitude depends on the phase space point it would like to avoid. So another approach is to realize that if I now have an amplitude that I calculate with these color rules that only involve conical deltas, and I would do this analytically, and I look at the expression and I collapse all these deltas, I contract them with each other until there's a bunch of conical deltas left that represents the external color, then this cannot be anything else than a sum of over terms that looks like what I write here. The eventual result must be a sum over all permutations for all possible combinations where you combine external color and anti-color indices times some coefficient that does not depend on the color. This must simply be true. This comes directly from these rules. There's no other possibility. There are only conical deltas here, right? And then for this object, you can easily find a color sum as in terms of a color matrix. So if I take the absolute value squared of this thing, then and sum of the color statements, just you contract these conical deltas, and the only thing that can come out of that is a power of nc. So you get a big matrix, which is there's a double sum, and each one is a sum over permutations of external particles. So for very many particles, this is undoable, but for up to, let's say, six particles, this is doable, especially because if it's only gluons, then lots of these coefficients are actually zero. But now the color sum is completely defined in terms of a so-called color matrix that you also can calculate once before you start generating events, and then take these numbers out whenever you need them. What I didn't explain you is how to get these coefficients. Now, if it's only external gluons, many of you already know, yeah, okay, these are the planar amplitudes, of course, the dual amplitudes, you get them from planar Feynman rules. But let's say if you have something more complicated, it is not only gluons, but also quarks and maybe some electroweak interaction. You need to think a bit about how to calculate them. And now the funny thing is that you can find this algorithmically how to find them by imagining that you give external colors to all the particles such that all external colors are for all particles are different, all colors and anti-colors. So the colors run from one to number of external particles, one to n. So you imagine that instead of SU3, you have SU infinity, and you assign colors one until n for the colors and one until n for the anti-colors. And as a result of that, going through the algorithm to calculate, to generate the skeleton, as I call it, to calculate this for this particular color configuration, selects only one of these terms. And this will give you exactly the skeleton that you need for this amplitude. So I have here an example for glue, U bar D, and a muon and antimuon and a neutrino. And if you do that, you get exactly, instead of one such a list, you get five of them. There are six permutations, one happens to be zero. And as you can see, they are not completely symmetric, they are different. So it's not so easy to get them just from planar Feynman rules. You need to put something extra in. And my message is that you can get this automatically again from the same algorithm. And these are, as I said before, these are these planar Feynman rules for if you have only gluons. Okay, it's a time. Mm-hmm. So, yes. So now, what I explained to you how to calculate the calculate the amplitudes, how to deal with color sums and spin summation. So to calculate the matrix element. I also told you at the beginning that I want to pay some attention to KT factorization, because that is particular for the program that I wrote, and is also for the terminology I will talk about later a bit. So this slide is essentially already, you saw already something very similar presented by Francesco Siliberto. And just like him, I concentrate on kind of, when I talk about KT and TMDs and so on, I mean the high energy factorization. And one of the essential ingredients is these off-shell pattern level matrix elements. And Francesco also mentioned those explicitly. So this is something that has to be mentioned. Now I see that I'm already 3/4 in, yes. And I think I need a short break. And I will continue after the break. So maybe you notice that this number, this line number, is bigger than one since the previous one. So I must admit that I decided before, okay, let's see how far I get to until the break. And if I manage to reach a certain number of pages, then I will continue there, or else I'll skip some. So I skip some, and I'm just explaining to you here more or less how to calculate or what goes into the calculation of these off-shell amplitudes, which means, let's say if you have a pair of off-shell gluons, what I'm talking about is in this red circle, imagine you have amplitudes for gluon goes to jets, four lines, four jets. Now imagine I want these initial state gluons to have an explicit KT, so they are space-like. Then if I would just, you know, calculate this amplitude like it is in the red circle with space-like gluons, that would not be gauge invariant. That would make not much sense. You need something to include something more to restore this gauge invariant. And you need to include some extra terms that I wrote here explicitly. I mean, a few of them, there are many more in general. So, and the way you can understand what you need there is by imagining that these gluons, that the process that you're looking at is not really gluons going into a hard process, but some high, very high energy quark scattering. So in the left hand side, there is this blob with a pair of lines, of dashed lines. I call them auxiliary quarks. And you have to imagine that they are very high energy and deliver only a small part of their momenta to the hard scattering process.
Excuse me, can I ask you the question?
Yes.
You said that if you have gluons with KT, you need something extra for gauge invariance. Mm-hmm. Don't you need similar thing when you have parallel gluon? Hello.
No. The idea is that if you have an amplitude and all external particles are let's say gluons, okay, and all external gluons are light-like.
Yes.
That object is gauge invariant.
Uh-huh.
But at the moment you compromise this kinematics and say, okay, one of these gluons here is not exactly light-like, it's space-like, for example.
I see. All right.
Then it collapses.
Okay, good. Thank you.
And so these extra terms that you need are, you get them, you realize what they are by imagining that you're actually looking at high energy quark scattering. And then it turns out that this tells you which graphs, like I draw them to it, take into account. And it turns out that the Feynman rules that you need to use for these extra auxiliary quarks are these iconal Feynman rules. So you don't have really a quark vertex in terms of a gamma mu, but there is just involved here is this what I call P1, which is the momentum of the initial state hadron. And instead of a real quark propagator, you know, with the 1/P/(k/), I mean, you have 1/P1.k, where k is the momentum, and P1 is the hadron momentum, the initial state hadron that is associated with the off-shell gluon. And So it looks, because it looks exactly like a process from the combinatorics, it looks like exactly like a process again that we use from the standard model. The way how to calculate this amplitude is dictated by the same principles as I was talking before. You just have more particles to deal with. Instead of a pair of gluons, you need to deal with two pairs of quarks. And it's exactly because what I described is a really efficient way to calculate amplitudes. It is not such a pain to have these two extra particles to deal with. So this works pretty straightforward. It's not much more complicated to calculate these objects than to calculate the on-shell amplitudes this way. Okay, I want to talk now a little bit more about the phase space. So, but let's see, what do I have to do now to generate phase space points for parton level calculation? I remember when I talk about generating phase space points, I really have in mind that I'm talking about eventually exact integration. Let's say something that leads to the exact integral if you have enough phase space points. There's no, it's exact to the level of perturbation theory, let's put it like that. So the first thing you need to do, you have a number of processes that contribute at parton level to a given, let's say, multi-jet process. So in the Monte Carlo way, you can, again, do, instead of explicitly summing over them, you can generate them event by event. Then once you have a process, partonic process, you need to generate initial state variables. Once you have those, you can construct initial state momenta and from those generate final state momenta. And once you have those, you can evaluate the matrix element, you can evaluate the PDFs, and anything else that goes in this numerator. Remember the important sampling formula, and you divide by all the probability densities with which you generated all these variables, right? And we can say this ratio, that is the event weight. And what I'm doing is I take the average over this W over all events, and that is going to be my cross-section. And with this, I can also calculate my bins, right? It was the same type of integration, just with some variable restricted. So I can say I generate events, I calculate the weight, and I throw the weight into bins. Okay. Right, so now the point is, in this ratio, especially this matrix element squared behaves very nasty. Nasty spikes and peaks and momenta become collinear. They cannot become exactly collinear, that's forbidden, but still they can come so close that this matrix element behaves nasty in this region. And you want this to be covered by this P that is below. This is the P that represents the density with which the final state momenta were generated. Right, so how to do that? And for this, what you can do, for example, what is appears to be very successful is to use this factorization formula of phase space. So now phase space consists of differential phase space number of light on-shell momenta. These are represent the external momenta of the final state particles plus momentum conservation. All these momenta, they should sum up to a given momentum that is dictated by the initial state momentum. And this formula here satisfies this factorization formula, which can graphically be understood as I write it here. Phase space, M particle phase space decomposes in an M plus N minus M particle phase space, where you just have to, where essentially what you do is you make one momentum to be generated intermediately, you write it explicitly as this Q. So it is a way to decompose your phase space. So now each of these blobs on the right-hand side, you can do the same until you have only three-point blobs, right? And for the three-point blobs, they represent two-particle phase space. And for this, we have a well-known formula how to do this. This looks all a bit complicated here. You don't have to look at the details about it. I just want you to know this is something we know how to do. This is a straightforward formula. You need to, depending on the whether the two particle phase space, the two particles that you generate, or the two momenta, depending on whether they are virtual or on shell, you need to generate first the invariants, or not. If it's an on shell particle, you don't need to generate it anymore. And after you did that, you need to generate two angles, and then you can construct these momenta, and you have it completely under control. You know with which density you generate those. You know all the Jacobians, so that's completely under control. So two particle phase space, simple. This we can do. And this formula says once you know how to do two particle phase space, you can stack two particle phase spaces one after the other and create an n particle phase space, right? So this is an example that I wrote here how they do it. So they have this tree structure. I use this enumeration of momenta where you do the external momenta with binary powers of two, and then you get for free a unique labeling of internal momenta. And so this is a tree structure that represents such a phase space, explicit phase space decomposition for a five particle final state phase space. So, and the idea is that every vertex represents a two particle phase space generation. So you start with this initial state momentum that I write here. So 1 plus 64, they together form, so the 62 is split into 14 and 48. So that's the first split that you want to do. So you generate two invariants, invariant number 14, invariant number 48. You generate two angles, and then you construct momentum 14 and 48. Once you have these momenta, you can do the same in the next step. Here, there's a particle number 2. This is a final state particle. You don't have to generate an invariant, but invariant number 12, you still have to generate. And then once you have those two angles, you can construct the momenta, et cetera. And this way, the nice thing about this approach is that you have control over the generation of these invariants. And since this is not a Feynman graph, okay? This is just a binary splitting representing phase-based decomposition, but it does look like a Feynman graph. And indeed, the idea is that, look, this number 14, right? This could be a Z boson. And for a Z boson, I know it has this resonance, and I would like to, you know, if this causes a spike in the amplitude, in the amplitude squared, and I want to cover the spike. So I want to generate my invariant in the phase-based decomposition. I want to generate it with exactly this density, so that it's covered, so that it cancels in this ratio. So that in this way, you can, you know, you can have control over the invariants that cause trouble in your matrix element. But okay, this is one tree structure that looks like a graph. There are many graphs. So, and now the idea is that, so the exact amplitude squared behaves nasty, but this nasty behavior is already more or less covered, especially if you do high energy physics where you are above all thresholds, is more or less covered by the sum of the squares of the graphs. And how to cover a single graph, that is what I just explained. Now, how to do a sum over graphs, or even a weighted sum over graphs, we know how to do that then. So you throw a random number, based on this random number, you choose a graph and you generate a phase space according to this graph. And you do this event by event. And what you eventually do is generate a density that is the sum of the graph. So we know how to do that. Now, there's this one thing that I would really like to mention, because I think it's very brilliant with these people, Gleisberger and Höge. Because when you do this, I explained to you at the beginning of my lecture how to calculate these amplitudes in such a way that you don't have to calculate graph by graph, but do it such that you essentially factorize the graphs such that you don't calculate things more than often than necessary. And now in the phase space generation, now I bring back all these graphs because you have to calculate for each phase space point the sum over densities. And then these people, they realize that you can avoid that not avoid that. You can get back the same efficiency of calculating the sum of these squirrel graphs by, instead of, you know, throwing random numbers and choose for each event a complete graphical structure for your phase space, you simply start by throwing by choosing splittings. So you start, okay, I have the sum of them. I need my first splitting. Okay, I choose one. Okay, I chose one. I generate my momentum. Now I have, for each of these two momenta, I need a new splitting. Okay, choose from the possible splittings, choose one. And if you do that, what you essentially are doing is, remember this blue list that I had, you go from down up the list, you choose splittings. And if you then want to calculate the density with which you generate phase response, you go back top down the list, exactly like in the amplitude calculation. So in this way, you really, the amplitude calculation, the phase space generator are very much matched to each other. And this is this paper of Gleisberg and Röhrke. This is the so-called COMICS paper. It has lots and lots of citations because it is integrated in the Sherpa system. It's essentially, they describe everything to do tree-level, pattern-level calculations, like what I was explaining. And they came up with this recursive phase space decomposition, which I don't think many people read that chapter of the paper, but I think that is truly brilliant. Anyway, so about phase space, there's one thing that I now want to mention regarding DIS, or let's say electron hadron scattering, in the context of KT factorization. That's the one technical thing that I wanted to mention in regarding electron hadron, because let's say the amplitudes and everything else is kind of more simple, but there is something specific in KT factorization with the DIS phase space. So I have here here's the graph for simple inclusive DIS, leading order, you know, just a quark, right? Quark electron scattering, let's say. And you mentioned in this block there's a photon, right? And I have here a complete formula. There's PDF, inner state variables, PDF, final state phase space, matrix element squared, and two delta functions that make this cross-section differential in Q squared and X Bjork. And I have here the TMD. If you would imagine that this TMD is just a PDF times a delta function, then this formula would collapse to the collinear factorization formula like you find in textbooks. Okay, this is nothing deep here. And then if you work out the phase space, we know if you do that for collinear factorization, what comes out is the statement that the X gluon that goes into the PDF is X Bjorken. We know this, and that's the whole idea. I mean, that is one of the nice things about this deep analysis scattering, that you have directly access to this X gluon. This is equal to this X Bjorken. Well, this goes immediately out of the window when you do KT factorization. This is not true anymore. So that is one thing. And of course, we know that if you look at something more complicated than just inclusive DIS, let's really say you imagine that you want to have, you consider a jet production, and you know that this is, that these formulas are such that this indeed is also not true, that X is equal to X Bjorken. But here, this in KT factorization is from the start. And the same for this formula that usually in DAS essentially gives direct access to the PDF is this formula here. So if you in collinear factorization take the differential cross section and you divide out the photon flux, you usually get just the PDF. But in KT factorization, it's not true anymore. You get this formula. And there is this, so here I have the TMD with the arguments X and KT squared. They're the ones that you usually have for the TMD. And then this formula looks like this, and there's a nasty Jacobian factor. You can write this differently by using different variables and say, okay, I'm not interested so much in exactly X gluon. Let's do a variable transformation. You can do that. And I have here one where I introduce a function Xi that is given here. And now you get rid of this Jacobian factor. Now you see if I put here KT squared to zero, and I inside this Xi, I put KT to zero, KT to zero, Xi becomes one. And you see, I would get PDF as function of XPR, and I get back at the formula that you are used to. But in KT factorization, you don't have this direct connection between these quantities. And
Andreas, yeah. may I ask you the question about this collinear? This is transparency 51, I think, about this collinear limit. If you assume something like this collinear factorization, if you assume the delta function, it means that in the unintegrated gluon, you are picking up the, in the cross section, you are picking up the value which is kt equals zero, right? Modulus.
Should I
put some four factor and then set this condition kt square equals zero in the matrix element instead of this?
What I mean is the following. I wrote down this formula, and this formula has a kt. So the first line, you can see that you cannot see my mouse, but I write here differential cross section equals to integral over x, integral over kt, and the kt appears explicitly in this TMD, etc. Okay?
Okay.
I'm just saying, if you, in this formula, replace this curly f by PDF times kt squared, that times delta.
Okay.
Then
yes,
this formula
fine,
collapses
fine.
To the usual formula.
Okay, you are right. Absolutely. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So the one thing that I will not explain in all detail, but what I was doing for hadron collisions in KT is in the initial state, what you do, you start generating X gluon, then you generate KT squared. This gives you the initial state momenta, and then you start generating final state momenta. And if I would do exactly that for DIS, this would mean that there's no control over X, Bjorken, and Q squared. And if you would, let's say, want to have a slice for a given X, Q squared, you would have to generate millions and millions of events, throw them in the bin for your value of Q squared, and hope that you get enough events. That would be extremely inefficient. So I made sure that I had to go through this exercise with all these integrals and so on to generate the initial state such that you have X, you can say, okay, I want events with Q squared equal to this. I want to have events with X Bjorken equal to this. So this is possible. Okay. So this is all about phase space. And now I want to talk a bit about phenomenology. I still have how much time?
Yeah. I mean,
6:15.
The next talk starts at 10 past six. So I guess we should have some questions.
Right. I'll be quick. Okay. So in this school, there was not too much talk about saturation. I know there are many people in the audience that know about saturation. And in general, I should say that when we talk about saturation has to do with the idea that if you go to very high energies, the density of the number of gluons in the hadron increases, but at some point they should stop, and this is called saturation. And this has some consequences, and there are ways to describe that, and there are ways to study that. And to study that is in general to look to make sure that the momentum fraction of the partons in the collision becomes as small as possible, so small x. You get this, for example, if you look at forward processes where the final state momenta are pushed forward in one direction, this implies one of the x's was small. And from the QSD point of view, it comes from non-linearity in the evolution of of BDFs. And the proper way to study or to describe saturation is color class condensate. And the disadvantage of color class condensate is that things can get very complicated very quickly. And if you consider something like, okay, I want to study two jets, is it possible to extract from this color class condensate formalism, is it possible to extract a formula that looks like we are used to, you know, factorized formula, something like BDFs or TMDs times hard cross section. And these people, Cyril Marquette and collaborators, who formulated such a formula for the situation where you look at forward jets and that are almost back to back. So I have here this formula, and it, as you can see, it has only, it has one PDF, called small f, depends on one momentum fraction. And this is not a TMD. So the idea is that this this is called hybrid factorization, that on one side has large x and you describe it in the collinear fashion, and the other side is the low x and you describe it in a KT factorized fashion. As I said, this is for jets that are almost back to back. And the peculiarities of this formula is that on one side there is a TMD, but on the other side there's an on-shell matrix element. That's one thing. And the other thing is there's not only one TMD, there are several. And there are several hard cross sections that carry an extra I, and there's a sum over there. And eventually this is a sum over color structures. And then with some collaborators, we kind of generalize this formula to the case where the jets don't have to be necessarily back to back. And so the KT, so the jets almost back to back means that the KT stays small. We generalized it to the case where KT can also become not so small. But this means that you have to include off-shell matrix elements that also explicitly depend on the KT. And it turns out that you can extract this formula. So the original formula was extracted from CZG. We originally proposed our formula as a kind of interpolation between this first formula and KT factorization. But then it turns out that this formula that we proposed can also derive from the CGC directly. So with this formula, we did some calculations. And one thing is that this formula is valid for two jets. And in order to tell you, to explain to you what this decomposition over colors that I said, what the hell does that mean? In order to explain that, I go to more than two jets even. And fortunately, there was yesterday the talk about Liu, and he explained already a lot of stuff. For example, what it means in this slide. So I don't have to spend too much time on that. I just show you this formula here that a TMD can in general be written as an object that is a matrix element of Hadron states with that sandwich field operators that are connected with a Wilson line. And we saw this picture yesterday already several times. We even saw these staple likes, you know, these staple like paths for the Wilson line. So this is how, and the idea is that you get an object like this by resumming soft gluons, right? That was the idea. And you have to go through all possible connections of this gluon to the, in this case, the imagine here to be an ion, the ion blob and all external and internal lines. So now I explain to you how to get to this formula with the decomposition of TMDs and color factors. Color structures in the matrix elements. And the idea is as follows. You take your KT factorized formula, so cross-section, TMD, matrix element squared, and I write explicitly, of course, in this matrix element squared is implied a color sum, and in this color flow, representation, it looks, the color sum looks like that, right? So there are a bunch of fundamental indices that are contracted with each other. So that is normal KT type of KT factorized kind of formula. This formula that we proposed, the improved TM, improved transverse momentum dependent formula, you get by replacing this color sum, particularly by a correlated color sum. So, and the correlators, the things that correlate the color are exactly this type of this type of formula that I showed you before, that is the definition of a TMD. But instead of only one or two Wilson lines, you have for every possible external connection, you have a Wilson line. Okay, so it becomes very complicated, looks like it. But that is a general formula. Right, so you can now imagine, okay, but wait a minute. I remember there was this decomposition formula for the colors, for the matrix element with these indices, right? That was with the delta ijs. So now what happens if I put that in here? And you can do that explicitly. And what happens is that this complicated formula collapses to a formula involving a color matrix that not only depends on powers and C, but on a number of TMDs. And each matrix element of the color matrix now has an explicit TMD. And independent of how many external particles there are, these TMDs that appear on this matrix are one out of these 10. And the explicit formula for these 10 are here. So they look exactly like they look like you expect them to be. There are Hadron states that sandwich field operators connected by Wilson lines, and these Wilson lines, they come up in various combinations, but there are eventually only 10 possible combinations that show up. So eventually you have only 10 possible TMDs that can show up, and the connection with how to have this thing with how which TMD goes with which matrix element is dictated by this formula, where you have your amplitudes and your color sum, but instead of just powers of NC in the color matrix, you have power of NC times TMD. Right, now you think, okay, 10 TMDs, isn't that too much? How am I going to deal with that? One is often already complicated enough. Fortunately, if you apply number of approximations, you eventually need to calculate only one, let's say, fit one to data, and then you can, for digest, for example, the ones that you need extra, you can extract from this one TMD, so you don't have to fit all 10 TMDs. And so we did this. So we tried to do the trijet calculation and extract the TMDs that we need for that. So the original one, let's say the one that is that you calculate and fit to data, is this F1QG, is this solid red line, and then the other ones are the extra ones that you extract from that. Yes. And now if you do a calculation and you want to study saturation, for example, the interesting observable is an observable that is sensitive to this momentum imbalance, to the KT. And this means that you would like to look at observables where if you would not have this initial state KT, they would be back to back. They would represent back to back systems. For example, if you have three jets, you take the two hardest jets and take the angle between the two hardest jets and the third jet. This angle would always be 180 degrees if the initial state KT would be zero. But because it's not zero, you get not a delta spike, but you get a distribution. And this distribution is directly sensitive to the KT. And therefore, this is an observer with which you can directly probe saturation. This distribution is sensitive to saturation. And you can see that, especially in this plot on the right, where there is a ratio between the cross-section, so this delta phi differential cross-section of proton-lead collisions divided by proton-proton collisions. And you imagine that the proton-lead collisions, the lead represents a denser system, so you expect more saturation there. And what you see is that around 180 degrees, this ratio becomes significantly, observably smaller, and this indicates, you know, saturation. This happens in the calculation because of the saturation that is put inside the TMD in our modeling. Okay. So finally, I should go to the let me skip that. Finally, let's go to DIS, because there you can also construct, of course, variables that are sensitive to saturation. And the nice thing, one of the nice thing for us in electron hadron scattering is that lots of things become simpler. Also, this ITMD factorization, because in the end you need only one TMD, and this is this what we call FGG3. This is also known as the Weizsäcker-Williams density. So we studied DIJETS, and if you look at the phase space, what would be sensitive to saturation here? What observable? Well, observable that in collinear factorization would be two systems that have to be back to back. And in this case, this would be, for example, be the sum of these jets, the momenta of this, the sum of the jet momenta and the electron momentum, the final state electron. So I have here a cartoon. So you have the final state jets, sum them up, and you take the angle between in the transverse plane between those and the electron. So if this x, let's say this x, let's say you do a collinear calculation, leading order, this means that there's no x here. Oh, you can't see my mouse. So this capital X here is like, it's not there at first order approximation, which means there's no momentum that can compensate for the system to be back to back. So it would have to be back to back, but in KT factorization, it's not necessary because you have the KT. So you can make a distribution of that, and it looks like that. And this, I skipped the part about the Sudakov resummation, because that is something you have to put on top of everything in the TMD. And you see it, this has also a significant effect in this plot. So that you see, first of all, that the proton curve is, there are two proton curves, one with and one without Sudakov factor, and there are two lead curves, one with and one without Sudakov factor. But you see that the proton is above the lead, that is the saturation. The lead is extra suppressed because of the dense system, but you see that the Sudakov makes things, the suppression even stronger. So that seems to be a disadvantage to include that you have to include that, so you lose, you know, kind of sensitivity to the saturation in a complete description. Now, finally, you might ask, but why would you consider this system? In the DIS, we always use this bright frame. It's so nice because in the bright frame, the jets would already have to be back to back. So if you look at the angle between the jets in the right frame, that is this left one here, and you compare it to our observable, you see that this sensitivity is less. So if you stick in the lab frame and you say, I look at the angle between the sum of the jets and the electron, see it's the difference, the sensitivity is more pronounced. And this is my last slide. So it's six. I thank you for your attention, and I'm awaiting questions.
Thank you, Andreas, for a very nice talk. So, are there any questions? Okay. I don't see any questions. So I think we
I have the question, if I may.
Yes, please go ahead.
So what is your project for the future? What do you want with all of this beautiful machinery to do?
I want KT factorization at next to leading order. That's simple.
So how feasible is it?
Well, from the things that I've been talking about, from this technology, it's not a big deal. It's more of a conceptual problem to make it how the virtual looks like, how the real contribution looks like, how things cancel, what goes into how the evolution comes in, etc. That's at the moment the problem. Once this is settled, I think there is a lot of machinery, you know, for collinear factorization at next to leading order one loop. We know how to calculate one loop amplitudes with a very similar approach that I showed to you for tree level. So that should be, that doesn't look like the big hurdle eventually. It is still a bit of the conceptual thing to make the pieces of the puzzle fit together.
And this nice trick with inclusion of Wilson loops, does it also work for higher orders?
Yeah, so now this, but you're talking about the TMDs or the
TMD?
Or the PMD. So this is not my personal specialty. So when it comes to the TMD part, I don't think I can answer to you.
Okay, so in your specialty, in higher orders, this Wilson loop trick, is it also there?
So in a sense, I do a kind of a Wilson loop trick in the calculation of the off-shell amplitudes, because this extra quark that I introduced, right, is essentially, this can also be interpreted as, here, where is it? This extra, this dashed line, right? Mm-hmm. This is something like a Wilson line, eventually. It can be interpreted. So there's a paper by Piotr Kotko where he explains that. And uh-huh. He comes to the same kind of formula as I have here, but he starts out from a formulation involving Wilson lines. And when it comes to this, the calculation itself doesn't seem to be straightforward, except that, let's say there is something occurring always like this, with the rapidity divergence, you have to deal with that. But right. on a operational level, let's say once you solved your conceptual problems, to write a Monte Carlo that does this, that's, I don't think, a big problem.
Okay, good, thank you.
Okay, may I have a question?
Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
How long does it take to generate these plots which you've shown? Is it minutes or hours or days?
What do this one have to generate? To generate such a table, a fraction of a second, okay? Then you need to do event by event, go through, let's say you generate phase space points, and then for one phase space point, you have to go through each this such a list, which means taking real numbers, multiplying them, et cetera, event by event. This still takes only a fraction of a second, event by event. But then if you want to, let's say, want to calculate a cross-section, which involves two, let's say, four jet calculation, then you're talking about a few hours. Depends, of course, a bit of your computer, but to have a nice plot, you know, with nice, smooth histograms, then you're talking about all of hour.
Thank you.
And then, of course, if you want to use these events to feed a parton shower and then continue with the calculation, it becomes more and more expensive, right? But for the parton level, tree level, we're talking about single CPU order of hour.
Fine, thank you.
Okay, any other questions? If not, then let's wrap up here.